How many have been to Louisiana, huh?
Thank you.
carefully out here on Johnson Street, about 60 yards up the road. You gotta imagine a little bit. We look very careful, we'll see us a 1910 Turlock tractor. Have you ever heard a 1910 Turlock tractor before? Have you? Listen carefully. If you look very carefully, who bring him up a 1910 tractor this warm September afternoon? You might spot what we call a Minnesota state bird. The mosquito. And then off to the left over there, I see a couple of EV-free lovebirds. Now, last but not least, if we look over the other corner, we see Turlock chicken. Chicken laying an egg? Okay, here we go. Let's start the train up now. Put your hands together, fellas. Come on, let's clap a little bit. Some hearts tonight. We don't know where you're coming from. Know a few people, but not the majority of you we don't know, we've never seen before. We just hope tonight we can get to know each other and have a good time in the things of Christ and in His Spirit. And that by this evening, when we finish up, you go home a little happier, head lifted up, and maybe some answers even coming, because this evening's given to the Lord. Danny's going to be one of His songs.
Yeah.
10 years ago, I picked up my boss's wife's violin. I began scratching around on it, and I wanted to rock and roll all my life. Well, anyway, first 24 years. and I never thought that I'd be playing a fiddle, but I picked it up. I kind of got interested in the thing, and I kind of liked that Cajun stuff, holding the fiddle down, and it just took forever to seem to find out one little thing that kind of got me going, and that was this. Well, that's a pretty hard thing to figure out, especially if you don't take any lessons, you know? And I was listening to records and trying to figure it out. It just wouldn't come. And finally, one day, I got disgusted, and I threw the fiddle in the closet. About 3 months later, I had these two dreams, two nights in a row. You'll be sorry, you know? So I kind of pull it out again. I start listening again. Finally, if you can get that part down, you're pretty well on your way. Then you got the rest of it to do, you know? But hey. So then I met another clown. I mean another gentleman, this amount of scholar who could too. So we've been having fun playing the fiddles. So anyhow, the Lord gave me this song 10 years ago, and he's the only one I want to play the fiddle for because he gave me the fiddle. He has a lot of neat gifts, I believe, planned for each and every one of us. If we're willing to just open up and live for him. Live for him. All I was doing was monkeying around with the guitar and rock and roll and nothing else. And he's been wonderful the last 10 years and just adding gifts and things. And I think as you commit yourself unto him, he's got some neat things planned. And the book says so. You know? So I wrote this song. It's called Play My Fiddle for the Lord.
Rock and roll.
You've heard of musical chairs? Well, this is called musical instruments. You're just gonna have to hang with us tonight, folks. We have lots of fun with all the toys, and so we're gonna kind of get, you know, around this stage as a small one.
I just had the opportunity to come back, or rather go over to Europe and England and then come back again with the Billy Graham Crusade, playing there. And Ted and I like to do all kinds of music from all over the world. He's one guy I met that multi-instrument talented, and so we like to mess around with all the different kinds of music, and American country music, bluegrass and Cajun and all that, and throw a little Russian in there. In 1976, I got a chance to go to the USSR through Siberia, way up there where they shot down the Korean airliner years ago, and took a Russian ship, the Baikal, and I took it from Japan over to Siberia and got on that train one winter time and went all the way. Took me weeks and weeks to get to Moscow, and I stuck a Bible in and did all that. And I was just telling Stephen Jernigan here, he goes to Russia, he was thinking about going there. I said, take some Bibles with you, because the guards might take them away, but they'll black market them, you know, to the Christians. And somebody will get a Bible, hallelujah. Just think of all the dusty Bibles we have at home. Well, you can just put in jail, so what? You can suffer for God a little bit. Anyway, it's better than getting rear-ended by some drunk on the freeway. But anyway, we want to do a song. You know, a lot of people are worried about the bomb. That's the big shadow of nuclear Holocaust hanging over our head. I don't think we know what Holocaust is until the Battle of Armageddon and things out of Revelation comes. That's really going to be something. But I think the Lord will take us for that, hopefully. But when I was in England, I saw a big banner hanging on the public building downtown in Norwich, England. It said, "No more Hiroshimas." And I thought, gee, don't they like Japanese cities, something? And I asked a man there, a statesman who came down off the steps, and he said, "Well, no, we don't. We don't." I said, "Well, you don't get what you want, it looks like, because it's going to happen probably, and you're not going to, unless you can convince Ivan to put his down, it's going to, you know." And, he was all nervous about it, and he says, "You know, the Lord has given us a way out. We shouldn't be concerned, you know, whether, you know, we fall in the bathtub and die, you know, there, you know, in a lather of soap, or we get, you know, nuked or whatever happens, you know, something like that. Because we're going to be with the Lord anyway." Paul says, you know, to be absent from the body, to be present with the Lord, hallelujah. This is the Christian's answer to the movie The Day After. "Now these are the times of trial and soul, and this is the home of the brave. It's here, USA, so don't run away. As for me, you can nuke me, I'm safe. Oh, nuke me, I'm safe, I'm safe. Uncle Sam's not afraid. Now things may get hot in the big commie plot. Push the button, he can nuke me, I'm safe. You can nuke me, I'm safe. You can nuke me, I'm safe from the grave. I'll be waving the red, white, and blue. Thank you, Lord, God, you can last. Your honor is at last. Hallelujah, you can nuke me, I'm safe.
I'm a German boy, and I was raised in Minnesota. Is anybody from Minnesota? Even Nolan's looking. It's like you're having a tundra. It's back in the Midwest somewhere. It's very cold in the wintertime. They had the worst winter they've ever had in 85 years my grandmother's been alive last winter. And I mean, it was really pretty bad. My sister almost died in it, and a lot of people did die in that area because of the cold and not only that, the severe thunders, the winter storms and the blizzards and everything, but I'm glad the Lord kind of called me out there. But anyhow, I didn't leave behind some of the traditional music and values of the German home. And this was the first instrument I learned to monkey with about 20-some years ago, probably 25 years ago. And I've been, you know, I'm a disc jockey in Fresno at the Contemporary Music Station, and yet I enjoy the country gospel, the bluegrass gospel, there's a gospel rock, I like the gospel new wave. But we began to sit down and deliberate about a year ago and said, there's one thing missing. And that is polka gospel. Polka praise. So we kind of put together a little tune that goes like this.
Thank you. should be angry, actually, righteously,
when people use the Lord's name in vain. It was one of the Ten Commandments. It's one of the Big Ten. It's right up there with murder and everything else. Sometimes we Americans think there's only one commandment, thou shalt not murder. But Jesus said, if you talk behind a brother's back, you know, you're murdering his character. This is a song like that. It reminds me when I was in the LA airport one time, and a woman was there, and she had a little foo-foo dog, you know, with a rhinestone collar. And I looked at that. My grandmother didn't even have a rhinestone collar. I'm watching this dog, it's all lavender, dyed lavender, in this little box that they put on the airplane. I was looking at that, and I thought, I wonder if that dog is going to survive at 25,000 feet. You know, or it's going to get compressurized. Who cares, right? Yeah. Yeah. Anyway, I'm looking at that. This woman's waiting for the man to come to check us in, and she used the Lord's name in vain. And I said, ma'am, I said, it's not God's fault. And she looked at me, remarked up, and she goes, oh, well, I'm sorry. And I says, well, don't apologize to me. You didn't use my name in vain. You didn't say, oh, Dan Agajanian, or Ted Jordan, or Walter Mondale, or Tip O'Neill or somebody. You use the Lord's name in vain. And he's my Savior. I said, if you knew him, you wouldn't talk about him like that. If you knew him, you couldn't stop talking about him. And she apologized, and sometimes it gets me, sometimes I hear it and I just pray, Lord, you know, touch their hearts, change them. Prayer is the strongest advocate we can have.
Staff by day. A tornado blew the
Do we have any daydreamers in the audience tonight, huh?
Yeah.
Five positive confessions and the rest are all over.
No, I wrote a little song about 6 years ago about daydreaming, because I really got involved in a time of my life where I wasn't happy with my circumstances, okay? And because I wasn't happy, I really couldn't live in the now, right? And that's kind of what happens when we're not too content. We tend to go to yesterday, or we go to tomorrowland, fantasyland, with our dreams and our hopes and everything else. You don't got the right guy or girl in your life, or right job or home, you tend to want to dream. And you know, the Bible says there's nothing really wrong with a hope. Hope is something that comes through the mind, the hope. But there's fantasy. And I think fantasy is kind of Satan's little tool. You say, what's the difference? Well, a hope, I think, is something where he gives us time to think about our hopes and our dreams in the right place and proportion and balance, and then we go back to work doing what we're doing today and being valuable for him now. Fantasy is where we completely push away the now and we do nothing but dream about yesterday or tomorrow. And I was really hung up in that for a few years, so I wrote this little song about it. It goes like this.
Stay.
stairs. Musical chairs gets us dizzy sometimes. I'll go to another one here. Okay, the Lord dealt with me on fantasy, and about 6-7 years ago, right about that time also, he began to deal with me on fear. Have you ever had fear? I bet you can relate to that, huh? I used to be the kind of guy who could climb into airplanes, man, and I got my pilot's license, and I'd fly all over. I'd jump into airliners and go here and go there, and I'd sleep in the back and just roll out, you know, when we got there. And about 7 years back, some things happened that kind of set me up for a real scare. And I was, I jumped into an airliner, and I sat down in Denver going to Midwest Sioux Falls, and here's this newspaper sitting, you know, in my chair, and it says, you know, football team dies in Illinois, an airliner, and another airliner goes down in Salt Lake, and I go, ooh, that's right over there, ooh, that's right over here. And it was a snowy night, and so I jumped in, and I was all set up. And we get to Sioux Falls, and the guy starts lowering in, and he says, well, we're not going to land here because we got a little wing problem. We're going to Minneapolis. And suddenly, I mean, something hit me, and I know it was fear. And fear is a spirit. And let me tell you, I thought we were going to crash and burn, etc., etc. You know, I mean, finally I got back. I had the hardest time getting back on that airplane to come back to the West Coast. I don't know why it happened, but it happened. But you know, I heard the Lord say, Teddy, you just, you know, you're not going to overcome by running away from it. As a little kid, man, I used to be afraid of the dark, noises in my bedroom. And I just knew those noises. I just knew those noises were going to pop up someday. Because out of us four brothers, I was the last one to get sleep. I was only rolling around my bed last. And I just knew the noise. Suddenly one night, boy, I mean, it happened. Marbles went down the steps, man. I mean, there was something knocking on the wall next to me. It freaked me out so bad, man, I dreaded seeing the sunset. And so I had a few things that the Lord had to dig out of me. Well, 10 years later, out here in California, he dug the fear of the dark thing out and he took care of it. I put me in an old dark hotel up in Chico, California for 5 nights in a row, man. But by the fifth night, man, I'd say I fought. And I crawled into that bed by myself. I said, man, I'm going to get victory. And by the fifth night, I got victory. Well, I had to keep climbing into airplanes, too. You know, it's happened. But you don't overcome. You don't overcome just by saying a prayer and turning away from your fear. I know we're all facing fears tonight. But Jesus came to set us free. What did he sing more than anything in the New Testament? Fear not, fear not, fear not. And what else did he say? Behold, I tell you the truth. Now, if you're going to get anything at all out of the New Testament, get that. Go away, not trying at least not to fear. He doesn't want you to fear. He wants, and he told us the truth. So I wrote a little song about fear. If we can remember it, it goes like this.
I want my crown, serving the Lord and my testify. Old Spookfoot, he once had me in his spell. Says Teddy boy, there is no heaven. Why you soon gonna die? You're gonna wind up here. Well, you know where he belongs. Slightly disturbed.
Saxophone stuff we're going to do, and some surf music for you Beach Boy fans, and so don't go, and lots more country, some dual evangelists and stuff, so we don't want you to run away, okay? And
a lot of us have friends who
we work with or go to school with or live next door to, who looks at us like, oh, you know, he's fanatic, he's overboard. He's this, he's that, you know. Hardcore guys, I don't know where the Lord draws that line where he turns them over to a reprobate mind, but, you know, we got to keep praying for people like that, you know. Because Paul, in the beginning, when his name was Saul in the New Testament, you know, he was a hopeless case. He was out killing Christians. He wasn't just talking about them. This is the kind of guy who, you know, is in any town, could be a town like this anywhere across America, and the skeptic, as it were. You just got to turn your television on to see these kind of people. They're all over the place. Maybe some of you people were that way once. The hardcore, the sneering, laughing.
Thank you. Before we get up and start devouring the goodies over here, we'd like to go ahead and take our offering. These folks came without...
You say that came from God, but if you show me a tip, brother, I'll call it like this for 50 bucks.
Here we go.
Thank you.
ought to take good care of that horn, man. Let me tell you.
Set right now. How many of you ever have enjoyed the beach music, huh? Beach music?
Yes.
Small minority here tonight, but that's okay. We still want to have some fun. And here's an old Jernigan song. Goes back about 20 some years. I know a few of us around back then. And get ready, boys. These guys have a tough time pretending to be Jan and Dean and the boys, but I think we can do it, okay? The students called Surf Witness and Surf's Up in Turlock tonight. Are we ready?
And that's, you know, alcohol. And
I know it's a touchy issue and all that. Close child molestation and abortion and all these things. I praise the Lord that there's some people up in the Capitol Hill in Washington are standing up against it. Praise the Lord. And even in the Soviet Union, you know, it's something that's damaging their society too.
He rolled out Sunday morning. He put his best suit clothes on. He's expecting to worship his congregation. And the doors swing wide open. But it's not Sunday school, because his church is a bar room and his pew is a bar stool. Someone gets too loud. The bartender's the preacher, and he's serving his crowd. And his choir is a jukebox when it's crying time. And when they serve communion, they serve brandy and wine.
Theme, and then I thought, how can I build this song? And so I did, and it's called You Can't Get There From Here. So now this figure, that's the theme, and you wanna write a tune entitled You Can't Get There From Here. And you wanna make it spiritual, see? So I rattled my brain a little bit, and a couple months later we came up with this. So we're gonna do it for you. It goes like this. Are you ready? Not long ago, when I was just a little boy. Martian took up a flying high. They went on high into outer space to take a good look around. Boy, did they have the answers by the time that they touched down. We looked to the left, we looked to the right, as far as we could see. There was no heaven, there was no God, most certainly no eternity. Well, I was just a little boy back then, and I knew it just wasn't fair. But then they say there was no God because you couldn't see him out there. The eyes back there, ladies and gentlemen, I would have given them some of my five-year-old gossip. I would have said, hey, Yuri.
That was his name, wasn't it? Yuri.
Yeah. Hey, you can get there from here, boys, can't get there from here. Well, the only way to heaven is to take a little time of prayer. You can't run, climb, walk, or fly, and no one gets you nowhere. Well, the kingdom of God is deep inside there. Those clowns in the eyes, and according to modern terminology, hip terminology, you know what I mean? He would have said, hey, you!
Get down!
Music, okay? I was kind of ugly and I was kind of thin, and I wouldn't let
Came over and goes, "What's the trouble here?" And they were in front of his tent, and he goes, "Two boys were fighting and one boy killed another boy, and he ran into your tent." And the sheik looked at him and said, "Well, you know the Bedouin law, the law of the nomads. He runs into my tent, he's got sovereignty. He's safe while he's in there." And they go, "But sire, you don't understand." He said, The boy that he killed is your son." So the sheik looked at him and thought a while and said, "Well then, I'll take that boy into my tent and I'll raise him up as my own." And that's how God does. Some of you people here think, "I've done a lot of bad things. I don't know if God's going to let me off the hook." Well, you just keep doing your laundry every day. Don't miss a day without doing your laundry. Talk to Jesus about what you do every day, what you've done. That's what I try to do. Because, you know, you keep tripping and stumbling down here. We're not perfect until we see Him. Jesus knows what we're going through. He went through everything we went through. Peter killed a man. So did Moses. Or Peter didn't kill a man. He cut a man's ear off. Wanted to kill him. Moses killed a guy. Lots of people. Paul did. There's a lot of people that are very harsh, you know. But you see, we've got to remember that God is merciful to the ones who jumps up in His lap and says, Daddy, forgive me, like a child. And you crawl into God's lap and say, Lord, I'm your child. Take care of me. He'll do it. I'll never leave you and forsake you. Now, somebody killed God's son. I have one little boy of 5 years old. I don't know if I'd give him for anybody in here, really. And here God gave His only son for everybody in the world, even the ones that curse Him, call Him names. I was on a sailboat trip with my cousin across the Pacific Ocean, just two of us on a 39-foot yawl. One October, we were leaving Honolulu from Papeete, Tahiti, and Honolulu, Los Angeles. My cousin says he was an atheist. But all the way on the trip, he was cursing God. I said, how can you curse somebody you don't even believe in? You're talking to God more than I am. When things got bad, I really talked to God, but it was in a different way. Clinging to that piece of wood like an ant on a toothpick. But you know, God looks down on us and He must cry and He must be very sad at what He sees. And it's not what we think makes Him sad. It's a denial of His son, because He's saying, what are you going to do with Jesus? But we're having a war over here, man. Like, what about the whales? What are you going to do with Jesus? We got thousands of aborted babies and little kids getting picked up and molested, everything. What are you going to do about Jesus? We're worried about the squirrels. Half the world doesn't have anything to eat. We got diet dog food and Alpo. I don't even eat Alpo. But anyway. But God looks down and He just wants us to come to Him. But this is a song about His son and how He feels about what happened. Is the rain only tears? God is crying. Is the wind just a faint lonesome sigh? Is an earthquake a father's heart breaking right in two? Because they murdered God's little boy. And don't you love Him? And don't you love Him? Don't you love God's little boy? They caught Him alone and far away from home. And they murdered God's little boy. Is the snow just a veil to hide God's sorrow? Is the green the envy of other gods? The yellow autumn haze, the golden ransom that He pays, because they murdered God. And don't you love Him? And don't you love Him? Don't you love God's little boy? They call the desert where He ran out of tears. And man cannot explain how God can love the ones to blame, because they murdered God's little boy.
left all of our microphones someplace else, and when we got here, no microphone stands. Stands, and we got the microphones, but no stands, so we kind of had to make do with it. We appreciate the church helping us with these stands tonight.
Talk about the banjo a little bit. The banjo, you know, was a very popular rhythm melody instrument and used in all kinds of minstrel shows before the Civil War. And after the war, the banjo got a bad reputation and kind of was attached to the South. There was a lot of sentiment against it. It wasn't until the ragtime era, the jazz era, that it got going again. And then still, America still kind of makes fun of the banjo a little bit too much, you know, with hee-haw and all that on the corn cob pipe and the banjo and the hay bales and all that. It's really our only real instrument that America can boast about, you know. And Ted and I were up at the Calgary Stampede playing, and a whole bunch of Japanese tourists come all the time. And, you know, I've done 3 or 4 tours in Japan, and the word for bathroom in Japanese is banjo. Someone came up to Ted, a Japanese tourist, and goes, what's that that you play there? And he goes, it's an instrument. Anyway, television themes have brought the banjo out a little bit.
Tell me, if you've been to one of our concerts before, keep quiet, okay? All right, you understand? Okay, we gotta get this clear. Can anybody tell me the name of the woman, I'm sorry girls, the name of the woman caught smoking in the Bible? It had to be a woman. Clearly states, what's it? What happened? She lit off her camel.
Okay, who is the guy in the Bible that did not have any parents? Keep quiet. Didn't have any mom or dad. You've been to our country before too. Now Joshua, he was the son of Nun.
Daddy wanted to take him outside, show him the graveyard outside the church, teach him about the world a little bit. We showed him the graveyard, and the little boy says, to his preacher, Papa, what are all those white markers? His father said, well, son, those are people who died in the service.
the little boy said, the morning service or evening service?
I had a dream last night that I went to heaven, and Ted and Agajanian got in the house before I did. So I was looking at him, and there's Agajanian, and he's handcuffed to Tiny Tim. And I said, Lord, what's the deal here? And the Lord says, well, Aggie was a pretty good boy during his life, but he still has to pay for some of his sins. And I looked over at Ted, and he was handcuffed to Bo Derek. And I said, well, Lord, what about Ted? He says, well, Bo Derek has to pay for some of her sins.
You're a chauvinist and all, and I says, yes, ma'am. She goes, well, where would you be if it wasn't for a woman? And I said, the Garden of Eden, lady.
Can anybody tell me where baseball is mentioned in the Bible quickly? The baseball, baseball. Eve stole first, Adam stole second, Abraham sacrificed, the prodigal son came home, David put out Goliath.
Oh,
me tell you, he was telling me about going to Canada and to Calgary, where it's just a beautiful city up there, way up above Montana. And he said, we'll play for 7 days, 12 hours a day. Are you ready? I kind of got a little fearful. I thought, my goodness, that's a lot of hours every day. But the 7 days, and he played 10 up there all together. I played 7, and it kind of instilled that kind of stuff in us. And can you imagine, we were with a welcoming committee, and we would welcome these airliners in from all over the world. And so we'd be down there at 10 o'clock, and we'd just pour for about 3 hours, then we'd take a little break, and then we'd pour for 3 more hours and take another little break. So we kind of get used to, but it gets into your blood. This kind of music really gets into your blood. So anyhow, we hope you don't mind us overdoing it there a little bit with Foggy Mountain, but it's good number, good tune. We're going to start wrapping down tonight, and boy, we've had a great time in being here. It's been a month for us since we played. Time goes so fast. For all of us to be together, we travel out and play, but we sure are grateful that the Lord is allowing us to make sure I get everything right. I got so many wires here. Hang on a second.
Make sure you're in one accord.
Okay. This last year has been kind of a neat year. And God's been doing a lot in my life. He really has. I feel like when I was 4 years old, a little boy back in Mountain Lake, Minnesota, I still remember where I was standing on the sidewalk. I heard a voice. You may say, well, are you sure? Well, hey, it's lasted with me, you know, 34 years. And I just heard a voice say, you're not going to be normal. You're not going to be normal. Come on. He says, I've got something special for you.
You stuck your foot in and get it out.
But anyway, I just heard, and I didn't know, I didn't really think, you know, it was anybody special. I mean, I just thought it was a thought. But I know that it was the Holy Spirit back then, because he's confirmed it to me today. He says, Teddy, I've been with you even before your mother's womb. And I've been kind of hanging out and watching and protecting you and loving you. You know, the biggest thing I'm waking up to as I drive down the streets today, folks, I look at people I don't even know sitting in a car next to me or walking through a crowd, and I think, Jesus, you know just as much about them as you do me. You took the time to create them, and you really would love to, maybe some of them you got great plans for, some you're working on, and God, I don't know who the ones are that belong to the Father, like the book says, the Father's planted and belong to him. But I know that you got neat things, and I'm constantly learning that. I don't know about you, but with 7 billion people on this earth, this little old mind wants to say, hey, now wait a minute, how can you be that personal God? But I know it. I know, and I'm learning more and more every day that I am, and that he's got neat things, and eternity's going to tell us all about it. But the Word and just the experiences and just the things he's given us these beautiful bodies that we can live in, our spirit man that lives forever, living in these bodies right now. We're learning while we're here. The heavens declare the glory of God. How can there be atheists? I think they're just fighting all the way because it's sticking out all over. But God gave me a new ministry last fall after I went through a real tough time. And he spoke to me and said, I want you to begin going out and loving people, not only when you're traveling on weekends, but during the weekdays before your radio program or right after your program. I want you to start going out to convalescent hospitals. And, you know, I kind of double-checked and thought, oh, well, I go every 6 months, but, you know, Lord, every day? And, you know, his peace just dropped into my heart. And he said, open the yellow pages and start calling some homes. And I did, and it's been about 8-10 months now, and it's been the blessing of my life. And some of these guys, and Danny goes with me whenever he can, and Steve, when he can, the other guys work, and we can verify that there's a special presence.